Oh, we're live.
You know, every Sunday night, except for where we're having our week off. From Mountain Time, 6 to 9, 8 Pacific, and 9 to 11 Eastern Time. Tonight we are talking about gears. And as usual, I have Mr. Cool Toes here as my eyes for the chat. So,
What's up? Ooh, hit myself in the head.
so I want to, Cool Toes, why don't you do your introduction?
You tell me to say
Go
something?
ahead.
You were cutting out.
Yeah, I said you go to your introduction.
I should have known that, actually. I am Cool Totes. I have a channel on YouTube. I've been kind of taking a little bit of break this month. It's Cool Totes on YouTube. Also, Cool Totes Pad on Facebook. You can also check me out in the Treasure Hunters group on Facebook. Really awesome group. Catherine Shelton's the Queen Treasure Hunter, I guess you could call her. But yeah, it's a pretty awesome group, so you can check us out there too as well. Cool.
And our guest for tonight is Andrew of Spokane Pickers. Please introduce yourself so people that don't know who you are.
Hey, I'm H from Spokane Pickers. Jake couldn't be here tonight, and we've been selling on eBay, Amazon for a couple of years, and in our antique booths for about 2 years. Just really excited to be here. You can find us on Facebook or on YouTube or on our website at SpokanePickers.com.
Thanks for being here. Well, I'll just start out with Sean. Why don't you do some shout outs to who's already in the chat since we're.
They're saying that we're boat row breaking up. So hold on a second. I'm gonna see if it's any better yet. But I'll go ahead and start that. Oh, let's see. I know Brian Arbitrage Albatross is here. Biscuit Head was there for a minute and then she had to leave, but yep, she was in there as well. And then Lauren West, who's new to watching the live videos, might become the Hungarian picker, not sure. Cool name. Matt Embry, as usual, welcome, man. Thanks for all the support. Mr. Sadie123, again, thanks. What's up, man? And Kathleen Brown, whoops, sorry, and Dana Bostic is here as well. Joseph Hare, how's it going, man? Welcome. Caesar's Palace, woohoo, he's here, the Gator Man Picker. Oh, excuse me, and I'm burping, sorry, man. Melissa S., what's up, how's it going? And I think that is all, let's see now. Yep, it's better now, so they can. Chris sounds like an alien. It's better now, so they can hear us.
Well, I can hear you. For some reason, my computer's acting up lately, so I may be breaking up here and there. Well, my first question to you is, how long have you guys been reselling, and have you ever done it? Were you doing it solo before you met?
No, we've always done it together. We've been friends for a long time, and then about 4 years ago, we started selling pretty heavy on Craigslist, and then eBay, and then about 2 years ago, we got into Amazon, and an antique booth, and, we've always done it together.
And in general, what do you guys sell?
We sell a little bit of everything. We try to focus on vintage items, things that are kind of cool, collectible, stuff like that. But really anything, you know, if we're in the thrift store or at a garage sale or wherever we're getting our items and we see something's valuable, we pretty much verify that it's valuable there in the field and then buy it and sell it. And there's certain things we kind of cater towards that we've done a lot of, you know. But besides that, you know, we're really open to anything.
Okay. And what is your biggest sale you guys have had out of the booth? Away from the booth, sorry.
Away from the booth? you know, we've had a couple of $400 or $500 sales on eBay, different items. We picked up a Spy Gear lot a while back that had some valuable items in it, and I think we got, you know, $400 or $500 out of a couple of those items, but nothing really over that, at least on eBay.
Okay, and you guys sell on Amazon?
Yeah, we sell quite a bit on Amazon. We've made a big push this last fourth quarter to try to get a lot of stuff in, but last year we kind of phased off. You know, in the spring and summer we slowed down a lot on Amazon and focused a lot on garage sales and selling on eBay.
Okay.
Do you do both FBA and merchant fulfilled?
We stopped doing merchant fulfilled pretty quickly. We don't do any merchant fulfilled. It's all FBA at this point.
Oh. Oh. Man.
I guess the reason for the merchant fulfilled stopping doing that is, you know, it's tough to keep up, and, you know, people on Amazon have pretty high expectations, and as beginners, I immediately saw a couple issues, you know, coming up with customer satisfaction and stuff, and we did not want to have the risk of losing our chance to sell on FBA, so we resolved those issues immediately, and then we just pretty much stayed FBA after that.
Yeah, was that based on, like, the type of items you were selling, merchant fulfilled, or?
Yeah, I think some of it was probably poor choice on, you know, the items. Mm. You know, like, for example, I can't remember which items were giving us a problem offhand, but, like, if you're selling potato chips.
Probably media, I bet.
Well, no, actually, it was food items with expiration dates and stuff like that. You know, that can really slip really quick if you buy a batch of, I think it was peanut butter, actually, we bought a batch of. And, you know, the expiration dates were, you know, 8 months out, but that turned into 6 real quick, and then, you know, 4 after that. So we have 100% feedback on there, but we did have a few bumps in the road with merchant fulfilled just because, you know, it's kind of tough to manage that as a beginner. You know, what products are, you know, need to be taken off and this and that. So
yeah, definitely. That is one thing I'm not looking forward to as far as, like, groceries and stuff, grocery items, once I get approved. Like, having to, you know, be aware of the expiration.
Yeah, we've also noticed, you know, we bought about $500 to $600 worth of bacon-flavored Pringles at one point. And we sent those all into FBA. They sold really fast, but there was definitely some issue with, you know, breakage. Of the chips, you know, when people get those, you know, they're not going to be happy if they're broken.
Yeah, so, no, definitely not.
So, I know, we just didn't want to, I don't know, that didn't really backfire on us, but I think it could have, you know, so.
Yeah.
Since you guys are such good friends, have you guys ever competed against yourself, each other?
Yeah, we definitely kind of have, like, it's an ongoing competition. It's fun going out there with somebody just daily and seeing, you know, who can kind of get the better item or the better deal or whatever the situation is. But, and we've never really had a super official competition, but, yeah, just at the daily competition, you know, trying to find that item. Every time we both hop out of the garage sale, even if there's nobody else at the garage sale, we're both kind of competing against each other, you know.
Well, yeah, I noticed that you did a video about a month ago of doing an East versus West, so that's what prompts me to ask if you guys.
Yeah. Jake went over to the west side of Washington and down into Portland and picked up a bunch of items. We actually never came out with a follow-up video to that, partly because we didn't really know how to choose the winner. He got a lot of actually really good items over there in Portland. And I got some good items that weekend, too, but we weren't really sure, you know, how to choose the winner, so we never put out a follow-up to that.
Well, make sure that your viewers decide who won.
Yeah, we should have.
Yeah.
And do you guys, do you see yourself, you guys always working together or trying to do it solo?
You know, I hope we'll always work together. It's definitely tough at times, you know, going in different directions, you know, two people have two different opinions on the way things should be done. And to be honest with you, Jake and I are very different in the way that we do things. So I feel fortunate that to this point we've been able to, you know, use that to our advantage instead of letting it work against us. But, I really don't know what the future holds, but I think that we'll be sticking together because together we really make a bigger, stronger team than we probably would separately.
You have any questions, Sean?
I can check. As I said, I remember you saying, you didn't like to process the stuff as far as like cleaning and stuff, but Jake did or something like that. And
things. Yeah, Jake's a books guy. He like pays a lot of attention to detail. Things have to be in line and in order and organized. And for me, I'm more of just like, let's push hard and let's get this done. Let's make money right now. I'll process items just on a pile of crap, you know, and just process, you know, junk, you know, right there on top of it. Right. Whereas Jake likes to have it organized, you know, have a pile here for, you know, what's been listed, what hasn't been listed, and, you know, this and that. So we try to blend that together and, you know, make something positive out of it.
Okay. Picker Smurf is in the house. I think I say Kathleen Brown. What's up? How's it going? Flippin' Thrifts is in the house. Gray is in the house. California Pickin', what's up? And there are no questions yet, but Picker Smurf, to answer your question, is this is H from Spokane Pickers, one half of the Spokane Pickers. Jake couldn't make it today, but so that's who that is.
Okay. I'm trying to get if anybody has any personal questions for him, please get them out now because I'm getting low on my questions already. And I don't want to fly through these. So I appreciate your help getting some questions in. And, well, you already said that he went to...
Because Chris has turned into an alien again.
let's try it again. You said that Jake went to the Portland. Where's the furthest you've gone together out of state to do some picking?
Let me think. We've went pretty deep into Montana a couple times, but that's it. We've never made it further than that. But we kind of hope to expand our horizons, but, you know, it's always tough to know. We were just talking about that the other day. It's really tough to know whether it's worth it to go out there, you know what I mean? And the time that we went out to Montana, we kind of did it as kind of a fun trip and did a lot of picking along the way, you know. But we kind of knew if we didn't find stuff, we were still going to have fun. But it's from a business standpoint, it's very difficult, you know, when we get a lead in Bonner's Ferry, Idaho, for example. It's difficult to know if it's worth driving 2 hours or an hour and a half over there to pick a barn. You know, you know there's a couple things in there, but you don't know what the people want for each thing. And, you know, it could just be a bust and you could have to drive back. So that kind of prevents us from going much further than maybe an hour and a half out. But, you know, hopefully we can plan some better trips in the future. And I think once we step our game up and we're a little bit smarter and, you know, a little bit better pickers, we'll be able to kind of turn those trips into more profit, too.
Could you see yourself as the American Pickers going around the whole country?
No, I don't think so. I think we have too much stuff kind of tying us down right here, you know. We definitely don't want to live life on the road, I don't think. But I can only speak for myself, but I don't think I would want to live life on the road and do all that, you know. And especially with the I don't know, just the propaganda involved with being a, you know, a TV person or whatever is kind of ridiculous, so.
Okay.
No doubt.
Any questions in the comment chat, Sean, that you can see?
Yeah. Do you have an antique booth somewhere? I'm sure that was one of the questions you had. But yeah, Kathleen Brown wants to know, do you have an antique booth somewhere?
Yeah, we have an antique booth, 10x10 spot, fourth booth in, right inside the door, at Pine Street Market in Spokane Valley, Washington, right on Pines and Sprague Avenue. And it's super busy. We love it. We love being in there. So we've been in there, I think it was 2 years in August. So we've been in there for a little while.
Cool. Did you guys ever sell that bobber cooler that you found?
Oh, yeah, the bobber.
I think you told me you did. Never mind.
Yeah, we sold that. Yeah, actually, I think those actually sell on eBay. I think we sold it in our booth, but I think they actually go on eBay. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Dude, we should have bought it when I saw it, because when I saw it, they were only like $20 or $15 or something. But yeah, now you can't find them, and they're, what, $30-$40?
Yeah.
Or more, I guess.
I think that's about what we got, $30-$40. Yeah. You see them once in a while. It's funny, though, because most of the time they're just beat down, and they're just in terrible condition, you know?
Yeah.
People actually use them. So you're looking for one for yourself, or what?
Yeah, just because, I don't know, just kind of cool to have. I never really go, like, fishing enough to really necessitate a cooler.
Yeah, right. I saw pictures on your Facebook of you fishing this summer.
my little 10-inch, or not, he wasn't even 10-inch, what was he, like, 8-inch bass? That little guy. He fought pretty good, though.
I never saw a fish. I just saw pictures of you fishing.
Yeah, I've caught a couple one day, and then another one that was about half the size of the lure. And I'm like, dude, what are you going to do with that lure, man? Can't even eat that thing.
Yeah, I grew up fishing. I love fishing. I wish I could go more. I need to start going a little bit more.
Especially up there, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think I saw a question in here.
There's a bunch now. Caesar's Palace wants to know how's your quarter 4 sales? You don't have to answer if you don't want to, but
quarter 4 on Amazon, actually, it's been decent for us, but it was just a battle for us to get enough stuff in. Pretty much everything we got in pretty much turned out how we expected. It was just a battle of capital for us, and you know, we did okay. We didn't do nothing worth talking about, that's for sure. So, and it was just that. It was just trying to get enough stuff. You get more and more and more and more in, you know. And we were shipping out some big lots, but not as many as we probably could have, you know, if we were a little more organized and had a little more capital. And so,
cool.
As far as a figure, you know, I couldn't even tell you a figure.
Counting guy, how's it going? He wants to know how did you guys come out on that Commodore software and stuff like that? And where did you sell it? Online, flea market?
Actually, that's still in the process of being listed on eBay. It's not even all listed on eBay right now. We have probably 90% of it still. I think we've sold a few disk drives, but it's looking very profitable, and it just needs to be listed.
Yeah, you look at it, you're overwhelmed. I was overwhelmed just looking at it, man.
Yeah, so that was a tough one. At least we got it cleaned, so that was a big thing. It was a smoker home, so it was, and it was big time smoker home, like thick layers, you know, whatever it is on the boxes and stuff. But at least we got that cleaned off right away, and it's just stored, cleaned, and ready to roll. So we're almost there. I think you know, a couple hard days, and we'll be into it. So
cool.
It'll be fun, though. It'll be a fun lot to get into.
Yeah. Melissa wants to know, where does your biggest profit come from?
What was that?
Where does your biggest profit come from, eBay, antique booth, or Amazon?
I would say we make the most money on eBay, and there's more power in eBay for us, just us specifically, because we're blessed with a nice area to get stuff, especially during garage sale season. We can bring in truckloads of stuff and just list it on eBay. I mean, list it for days and days and days. So that really turns the money quick on eBay. Also, Amazon is profitable for us. I would say it's kind of a tie between the booth and Amazon. The booth is very consistent, though, and really all we do with the booth is we put our leftovers in there. We sometimes buy stuff just for the booth, but the most of the time it's just our leftovers and kind of vintage-y items that don't quite make it onto eBay, and we just kind of blow them out in the booth, and it seems to work well. So I would say eBay is probably our leader, and you know we do want to push harder on Amazon and get to the point where, you know, Amazon seems like it's a more scalable option, but at this point it's eBay.
Cool.
Okay. Another question I have is. Well, you probably already answered it, but
it's an interesting question. Didn't hear you, man. Uh-oh.
Okay.
There we go. You're back now. Kinda, sorta. Being auto muted, yeah, I see that.
I was going to ask what. Are you...
Something with YouTube today, I bet. Vickers Church had a huge problem. They couldn't even have their show.
Really?
Yeah.
My computer itself.
Yeah, the booth's been really good to us. You know, I think that one of the biggest things that I've realized that's crazy is when we first went in and got the booth, it was not that big a deal, and there was not a waiting list or anything like that. And then the area that we got the booth in really grew and kind of exploded in popularity. And then actually last year, a Value Village moved in next door. So that was, you know, just super, super good luck. But now that's obviously a good location. Now there's a crazy waiting list. So
there you go.
You know, that's the thing. It's like, yeah, I look around for a place that is really popular, but it's almost like buying a home or buying a business or something. You know, it's like you have to like kind of anticipate how it's going to grow, or if you can get on a list and wait. But I think it's a pretty long list to get on where we're at. So okay. I don't know. It's just kind of an interesting thing
out. With
yeah. The booth, you know.
Heck yeah. Hey, Angela Martin is in the house. What's up? Welcome. Caesar's Palace wants to know what your guys' plans are for 2015.
Plans for what?
For 2015. Do you have big goals set?
Plans for what now?
For 2015, next year?
We really want to push towards having a very, very organized, structured business instead of, you know, just kind of... So we really want to sit down, lay out some structure for what we want to do on a quarterly, daily, hourly basis and really make it happen, and just push on that every single day of the week until we reach our goals, because for us, you know, we're also friends, so a lot of times, you know, we end up getting sidetracked or whatever. But we really want to push to make something happen in 2015 that's really structured, organized, everything accounted for. That's really our big goal.
Yeah, if I tried to account for everything, no. Yeah, that would not happen on my end. Like, how'd you make this? I have no clue. Uh-oh. Am I frozen now?
No, I heard you.
I was gonna say, H looks like he's contemplating something there. Hey, California Pickin wants to know how you guys work
out.
No,
you're breaking up. I didn't hear the end of what you said.
Oh, am I now? Shit. Crazy. Let's see. All right, who's on? Who's not breaking up? All right, if you can hear me, California Pickin wants to know how you work out the money part. Investment and then profits, one account, that kind of thing. How do you just decide that? Or not. Holy moly.
You broke up a little bit. Is the question, how do you decide who gets the money? Or how do you decide who gets what portion of the money? Is that what the question is?
Kind of, yeah. Just, I mean, how do you have a certain percent going into inventory and back into the business, and then you go from there, or how do you guys decide that?
Oh, how do we break up when our clubs come in? Our strategy is every I think this is the answer to the question you're asking. Every 2 weeks, we take 10% for ourselves. You guys there?
Yeah, we're here.
So what I was saying was basically we take 10% every 2 weeks per person. So, you know, if we made $1,000 in profit, we each take $100 of that. So 20% total, 10% apiece every 2 weeks. That's basically just eBay. At this point, we take our booth check, we pay for our rent in our booth, which is $185. Then we take 20% of the profit and we put it back into the business and we split the rest. So we kind of have two different ways to do the booth and a way to do eBay. And Amazon at this point just goes back into the business, and we just reinvest most of that capital back into Amazon. And that's just because we really want to build up our Amazon, you know, FBA inventory. And you can't really go wrong, you know, when you're looking at stuff and it's going to sell eventually, you know. So.
You guys are full-time, right? You don't have outside jobs?
No, yeah, we're full-time. Yeah. There's no other
job. 10%, if that tells you something, man, it's awesome.
Well, you know, we both have other sources of income, but it's, you know, not jobs or anything like that. And
just other streams and stuff. Cool.
Yeah. I used to have a decent paying web job, and I still hold part of that. And get a little bit of money from that. And Jake has other source of income too. So, you know, we're not dead in the water, but we're definitely making enough money to stay full-time. And I think a key to that too is all three streams, you know. If you were to take away just Amazon or just eBay or just the antique booth, it would hurt us big time. We really do rely on all of those, you know, kind of working together. And having those three legs really has helped us bring in, you know, something every month. So
awesome. Cool. Are there regulations on what's considered antiques where you're at your booth and stuff?
Absolutely not, and that's awesome that there's not, because we sell.
So they're making jokes in the chat.
Oh, wow. They're going crazy in there.
I know.
Funny. Yeah. YouTube bugs got us too, man.
So, I don't know. I just...
Yeah. Ah, Picker Smurf. Yeah, no, my headache's not totally gone yet. It's still there.
Pay me one of your questions then. When you were having your booth, did you have to work the booth? I worked the place at all?
No, they, I didn't have to at the one I was at. It, luckily, because there was one other one I was looking at, but it was about 20 minutes up north of me. And with my truck, it would have not been any good because I'd had to been there 3 days out of the month. And on top of that, it was almost $200 for the space. And I wasn't really up to that point of being able to find that much stuff yet. And so instead, I chose one closer to me that I didn't have to work at. And it was more of a showcase than an actual... like whole booth, so it was only $60, 60 or 65 a month. But yeah, I didn't have the motivation to keep it up, so I just left it, and I was gonna leave it. And then the month before that, though, they told me that they were gonna take out a lot of the cases and turn them into full size booths, and they're gonna be $250 a month. And yeah, they gave. Based on how long you were there is how, you know, if you got to first dibs at a booth or not. So either way, I was going to be out. So.
Okay. All right. You back? H?
I'm back.
Woohoo.
Okay, well, I asked you on that a question that I was going to ask.
What's the question now?
You're supposed to guess. You're supposed to be psychic, apparently.
Man. Do we have what now?
At the booth that you guys are like at the place to.
Man. Angela Spokane Pickers is two people. They're both friends for a few bunch of years. So yeah, to answer that question for you. Yeah, YouTube's been crazy today. Trying to find other questions. Alabama well, Pickers, what's up?
Check the our chat. Check our chat. See if you can.
Uh-oh. I already did ask that one.
No, I meant the one I asked you. I was trying to have you ask him the same question I asked you.
I remember the exact wording.
Yeah.
What's up?
I need to get drunk. Freaking YouTube. You ask. Huh? What you need to get into the booth?
So, hey, you know, while
We are so lost, man. And this isn't even a Toadcast. We're just crashing and burning anyway.
Hey, while we're on the topic of antique booths, while we're all frozen, I just want to...
Oh, never mind. Damn, dude. So, let's see. Yeah, definitely something you guys want to do. Get a booth if you can, or like a small case. Yeah, it's pretty fun, actually. But, yeah, it's cool. Go out and check things out. Angela Martin needs a leftover booth. And he's back.
Back, guys. Is it me or is it you guys, you know?
It's all of us. Yeah. YouTube was having trouble earlier today, too.
Before I forget, I wanted to say... check out Pudgy Picker on YouTube. She's a
there
pretty,
you go. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, she knows all about antique booths, so...
She's awesome.
Yeah,
and her booth, she actually can sell other things, too.
So. Yeah. Check out her intro is awesome. I love her intro, her little theme song. Yeah. That's dope.
Yeah. Holy moly. What advice can you give to newbies who want to get into booths and stuff like that?
I would say just dive in, you know, and I guess answer a couple questions first. First of all, do you find enough stuff really to stock a booth, whether it's a, you know, a 10x10 or a smaller one? Do you really find enough stuff? And when you think about that question, definitely think about what price you're going to be selling it, because if push comes to shove and you just have to blow it out, and that's been one of our techniques. I mean, you can price stuff in a booth to the point where other resellers will buy it, take a chance on it, you know. And that's, you know, so you can price it that low, so it's just like, can you blow it out at that rate and still get more stuff to put in there and keep it full and keep it looking good? And if you can, you know, what's the traffic look like in the area? And that's the second thing. It's like, is it a location where there's enough people coming in to actually buy that stuff and move it out? And then the third thing is just find out, you know, save up, you know, 2 months rent, 3 months rent, whatever it is, if they have a lease or whatever, maybe it's more, but save up a couple months rent and give it a try, and just push hard for a couple months and see if it's doable. And also, I would say, for us specifically, it was definitely a lot easier to start in a summer month. You know, we were pushing real hard at garage sales, so we had just backlogs of stuff to ready to be pushed in there, and that helps a lot. I can't imagine starting a new booth right now with the inventory we have because of the time of year. It would be a lot tougher to start it up in the winter for us because there's not near as much cool stuff out there. There's no garage sales here, so. Start it in the summer if you have summer garage sales, you know.
Definitely also go look at the booths and things to kind of see what people are doing, you know, how they have them set up, you know, what they have.
What's that question?
I was just saying that people should definitely go look and see, you know, in the place that they're thinking about and see how people have them set up, what they're selling, you know, who's there, kind of a thing. Ask the other booth owners, you know, questions, definitely, or even the owners of the place, you know, whoever runs it.
Yeah, that's a great tip. If other vendors aren't happy, you know, there's a chance that you're not going to be happy either. The other thing is we pick the other vendors. You know, there's a lot of other vendors around in the same building, so we'll actually go to the other booths every once in a while. And I don't remember the model number. I wish I could tell you, but Jake actually found one of those really, really big old school super soakers, the purple ones. The ones that they took off the market because they blow your eye out. He found one of those a couple booths down at a guy's booth, and I think it's going for like $300 on eBay. He got it for $10, so you never know what you're gonna find in the same vendor mall. We bought.
There it goes again.
And I was just about to ask that question too.
If you're in there at a different vendor, and I think we sold it for 40 or 45 or something like that. So
sweet.
I was just about to ask you if you bought from other booths or not to resell.
So we pushed out plenty of product in from our booth. Well, I think what you're asking is if we bought from other booths, and yeah, we buy from other booths, and we also sell if it's slightly broken or if it's just a headache, you know, it needs to be super cleaned or whatever the problem is. We'll push a lot of that stuff out too, just real cheap, because it's faster and more profitable for us just to get rid of it and move on to the next thing. So, you know, other people have definitely made money off our antique booth, I'm sure. And I'm sure that goes into other people too, you know, some of the reasons they put some of their valuable items in their booths.
Okay. You guys refurbish your stuff, right? Some of your stuff?
What's that?
You guys refurbish some of your stuff? Like some of the older items and stuff that you put in there? I mean, I know you clean them up and stuff a little bit, but somebody's asking, do you refurbish your items?
Oh boy, we really have it.
Yeah, it's going nuts.
Sorry, everybody.
Craziness. Justin Starcher's in the house. What's up, man? Karen Petrosovitz is in the house. Sorry, I've
been around.
Even hear you, man. I hear like little bits and pieces, but
welcome back again.
Thanks, man.
Yep, welcome back. Yeah, was thinking that too, Chris. Somebody had asked H if you guys have been thinking about doing books or anything for Kindle. I think you'd said no before, but has that changed at all?
We've thrown it around. We've talked about it and thought about whether it's profitable or not, you know. And I mean, I think it could be. Obviously, it's profitable. Otherwise, people wouldn't be doing it. But it just kind of comes down to is it going to work into your game plan? At this point, it hasn't worked into our game plan, but you know, maybe in the future.
Cool. not totally out of the question. It's just not quite now.
Yeah, and, you know, in my previous job, I've written several guides, PDFs, and stuff like that. So it's not like Jake and I aren't capable. We're tempted. You know, we've even talked about some possible topic ideas. But that void's kind of filled, too. You know, there's a lot of folks involved in that. It's crazy because it makes you think back to when you first thought about that. You know, there's so many times, you know, years ago when Jake and I said, hey, let's start a university. You know, let's start the Picker University. You know, 2 years ago.
That would be cool.
Had an online subscription-based product. You know, so it was something that we were really interested in. We thought might be a good idea, but ultimately we just decided it wasn't for us, and we still wonder, though.
By the way, Bama Picker, it's not the lampshade that's crooked now, it's the mirror, so.
What's that?
I was telling Bama Picker, Alabama Picker always complains about my lamp in the back being crooked, and I told him it's not the lamp tonight, it's the mirror that's crooked this time. Holy. Yeah. How do you prevent theft from your place? You kind of can't, really. I mean,
you still have a booth shop?
I don't anymore. Yeah, I just had a little. It was more of a case than a booth, but.
How do we prevent theft in a booth?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I remember. Yeah, the case that you had.
Yeah.
So as far as theft, we have been hit with theft in the booth. There's actually a security camera in the same booth as our, in the corner of our booth, and we still have people steal stuff. We've got a lot of, like, baseball caps like this stolen, snapbacks, little things that aren't in the case. But once again, our booth is our extras and stuff we're trying to push. It is not, you know, we are pretty careful not to put anything extremely valuable in there, especially if it's small. We have had some really cool things broken, though. What was that? Well, we had a Mercury.
Man, I wanted to know about that, too. He said Mercury.
Big long glass tube with mercury in it.
Ah, there you go.
Somebody smashed the glass out of that. I mean, that was probably a $75 light. Damage, but I'll tell you what, we wouldn't trade it for the world.
Uh-oh. That's cool, man. Yeah, much trouble to get it on.
Everybody, I'm sorry. We're having so much trouble. I'm going to try having this again. Maybe Asian Dick can come another night in the new year. I got to end this because it's driving us nuts.
Understandable. Well, hey, thanks for having us, Chris. It's been a pleasure talking with you and Sean.
Dude, yeah. It's been fun, man. Thank you.
Like I said, hopefully you and Jake can work something out and come again another time.
Yeah, absolutely. Let us know. We'd love to be back on.
I will let you know.
All right. Thank you. Have a good night.
You too, man.
Bye, everybody.